Happy Sabbath. Good morning, Upper Room. I'm blessed to be here with you. Before we get started, I want to ask you a question. So how many of you guys have gone into a test that you feel totally unprepared for and then come out with a better grade than you expected? I don't know about you, but that has definitely happened to me multiple times, aka this past week in college, because you don't always have the time you want to prepare, and yet sometimes that teacher might show you some mercy and show you some grace on that results of your test, because I remember my accounting teacher currently, she always gives you an extra credit question, and you get up to 5 points, and even if you just write something down, she'll give you 2. I'm like, okay, I don't have to know it. But anyways, so let's go ahead and bow our heads for a word of prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, God, I just want to thank you for this morning. I want to thank you for your amazing grace, for bringing us all here together to worship, to praise your holy name. And Lord, I pray that as I speak it, not be my words that come out, but it be yours, because Lord, you're showing us your grace. You're calling to our hearts. And God, I pray that you hide me behind your cross. And Lord, I pray that I'm effectively to speak the message that you have provided this morning. Your precious and holy name I pray. Amen. All right, so let me grab my notes so I know where I'm going with this. But one thing that I've been realizing is that God has given us this incredible gift of this amazing grace, yet I don't deserve it, you know? So I remember last year I was sitting in the campus ministry's office over at Southwestern, and I was talking to one of my friends, and he was asking me, Kayla, what's the difference between mercy and grace? And I kind of was like, I'm not exactly completely sure. And so we started talking about it more. And mercy, he told me, he's like, okay, so say you're driving your car. So driving my car, I don't know about you guys, but I speed. That's something that I always do. I'm sorry to admit that. But I'm always speeding, so sometimes you can get in trouble for speeding. And so he said, say the police officer pulls you over, and you get fined, like, say, $150 for speeding. And that's a lot of money, especially if you're a high school or college student. You have no money, even if you work so many jobs. And so he's like, say you have to pay this $150. And I'm like, okay. And then he's like, now say that the police officer just says, okay, I won't give that to you. Is that grace or mercy? And I was like, well, that's grace, isn't it? He's like, no, it's mercy, because no one's paying for it. I'm like, okay. And he said, but say you get that $150 ticket, that $150 fine, and the police officer pays it out of his money for you. And he said, that's grace. And then we got into this whole discussion about, like, wait, like, I wouldn't deserve it because I'm the one who broke the law. I'm the one who sped. And he said, exactly, because that's what God does for us. And so I don't know about you guys, but if you've ever been enslaved to that thing that just holds you and you feel like you can't let go, but you're holding on and it's tearing you apart. And the crazy thing is God has this amazing grace, and he wants you to give it to him. So I don't know, how many of you guys are the youngest sibling in your family? The youngest sibling is the awesomest job in the world. You get to be the most annoying, or at least that's what I always do. So I have one older sister, so she's a year and a half older than me, so I always was a brat, and I was like, you're not that older, you're only a year older. And now we're like best friends, but that's kind of cool. But so my sister's name is Carissa, and I remember this one time, I don't even know what we were doing with our lives, but I know I was just being mischievous, and being the younger sibling, I always took it upon myself to blame my older sister for everything. So I would do something, and I'd get in trouble. I'd be like, no, Carissa made me do it. And she would always get in trouble because they believed me. Sorry, Carissa. But so I remember this one time, I don't even know what I did, but I did something super stupid. And my parents, like, I knew we were, or I was going to get in trouble because my sister didn't do anything. And she was just kind of like, haha, you're in trouble. You can't blame it on me this time. And I was like, okay, what do I do? You know, and so growing up, I avoided getting a spanking as much as possible because I was like, no, I do not want this. So I remember, like, I knew that I was going to get this spanking. So my dad comes in, and I don't even remember what I did, guys. But my dad's like, okay, Kayla, you're going to get a spanking. And so it kind of like, it reminds me of Romans chapter 6, verse 23, which the first part of that verse says, for the wages of sin is death. Yes, I was not going to die this day. I was probably like 3 years old, 3 or 4 years old. I knew I was going to get a spanking. So the wages of what Kayla did was a spanking, right? And I was like, dang it, I do not want this. And so, like, for us as humans, when we sin, we're signing that contract for death. Because death is the result of the thing that we do when we sin. And so my dad comes in there, and my sister's in there with me. And my dad was like, okay, Kayla, like, bend over. And I was like, no. And then my sister was like, wait, Dad. She was like, I'll take the spanking for Kayla. I was like, what? I'm like, what do you mean you will, fam? Like, really, you love me? Like, for me, I'm like, whoa, like, I'm a terrible person. I would always just do things to torture my sister and just annoy her, even though she would annoy me back. But she was like, no, Dad, like, I know Kayla did this. And she was like, but I want to take her punishment for her. And, like, that really just struck me because I was like, I'm, like, 3 or 4 years old, and, like, I'm, like, just hype. I'm like, yes, I don't have to get spanked. I'm like, ha ha, sucks for you. And I'm like, wait, like, that shouldn't be my mentality for this quote-unquote reward that I've just been given, this gift from my sister. Yet, is that what we do with God? Because God sent his son, Christ, as we saw in the video, like, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son to us, to sacrifice in death, because, as Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death. So forgiveness is not necessarily mercy in the sense of saying, okay, you're good. No, the price had to be paid. Because if the price wasn't paid, God wouldn't be a just God. You know? So when Christ came down and he died for me, he died for you. It was because the wages of your sin, the wages of anything you've ever done that was sinful, every thought you have ever thought that is sinful, he died for that in you. Because Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Because the sin had to be paid by death. And yet Christ looked at you and he said, you're worth it. You're worth every bit of my death so that I can have you in eternal life. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I'm just like, haha, sucks for you. You have to die, but I can be free. But no. That is not the mentality we are supposed to have. Because for me, I am a sinner. I will admit that. I will admit things I have done that I am ashamed to say that I've been a part of. But when judgment comes, I know who's going to be standing in front of me because I have accepted this free gift of eternal life in Christ Jesus. So I don't know if you've ever heard of the donut story, but it's one of my favorite stories. And so it goes like this. So there was a teacher. He was teaching a Bible class at a university, and there was this one student. His name was Steve, and Steve was a captain of the wrestling team, I think. I don't know. I have the story right there, so I can refer to it. But he was a captain of some team, so he's pretty strong. And Steve wasn't really interested in this teacher's class, and the teacher knew that. So one day, the teacher asked Steve to stay behind. And so Steve stayed behind class, and the teacher asked Steve, how many push-ups do you think you can do, like, in a setting? And he was like, well, I do, like, 200 every night. I don't know about you guys, but 200 is a lot of push-ups. And I'm not someone who likes to do push-ups at all. And at camp this summer, we were working, and I was girls director and my guys director. The guys counselors decided they were going to do 200 push-ups a day. I was like, you guys are crazy. And so we would be like driving around camp in our golf cart, And then Adam, my guys director, he'd be like, okay, Kayla, count how many push-ups I do right now. And I'm like, what? We're going to a meeting. And he's like, yeah, no, I got to do it. So he would just randomly do push-ups. But 200 push-ups is a lot. And so then the teacher asked Steve. He was like, Steve, do you think you could do 300? And he was like, I don't know if I can do 300 in a row. He's like, 300 in, like, increments of 10. He was like, yeah, I think I can do that. He was like, okay, come Friday prepared to do push-ups. And so Friday comes around. The students are sitting in their seats getting ready for the lecture. And the teacher, he comes in and he has this big box of donuts. And they're not just your plain glazed donuts. These are the ones that are like the big, fat, juicy ones. Like if you like the cream-filled, they're those. Like they're like the best donuts ever. Like I don't know if you've ever gone to a really fancy donut shop and got the really good donuts. So these were those donuts, right? And so the teacher goes to the first student. Let's say her name's Susan. He's like, Susan, would you like a donut? Susan says, yeah, sure. And so he turns to Steve and he says, Steve, will you do 10 push-ups so Susan can have this donut? And Steve gets down, he does his 10 push-ups, sits back up in his chair. He goes to the next student. Bobby, would you like a donut? Yeah. Steve, will you do 10 push-ups so Bobby can have this donut? Steve goes ahead and does his 10 push-ups. He keeps going to the students, and he comes to one student. Edward, would you like a donut? I can do my own push-ups. No, Steve has to do your push-ups. Would you like a donut? Well, then no, I don't want them. Steve, can you do 10 push-ups for the donut that Edward does not want? Yes. So Steve goes ahead and does those push-ups. And so you're going around the room, and then I remember, like, a student starts to come in the room, and everyone's like, no, go out. We don't want you to have Steve to do these push-ups for you. And so Steve keeps doing these push-ups for every student in the classroom. Whether they want the donut or not, they have the opportunity for it. Because you see, Steve was getting tired and he was getting exhausted. And he did all these push-ups for everyone. And then he comes to the last person and he just collapses. He finishes because he's getting really shaky. He did a total of 350 push-ups. So that's 150 more than he normally does on a day-to-day basis. And yet he did this for the opportunity for every student in the class to have a chance at tasting this amazing donut, whatever it was. And the thing is, that's what God does for you, and that's what God does for me, because the thing is, he is the perfect sacrifice for you. Because going back to the Old Testament, the sacrifice had to be without blemish. The lamb had to be the best lamb of the flock. It had to be one without blemish, without anything, because it needed to be pure sacrifice. And the only human that could possibly do that was when Christ came down. And we always recite John 3:16 together. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son to forgive. You know what I mean. But John 3:17 goes into, for he did not send his son to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Because, yes, I don't know about you, but so many times I've been like, okay, I don't want to listen to the Ten Commandments because it's a list of rules of things I can't do, you know. Can't steal, can't lie, can't cheat. And, like, for me, I hate rules. I don't know about you guys, but rules have always seemed so limiting and so confining. Yet, God did not put the Ten Commandments in a place to be like, okay, this is a list of don'ts. Rather, he put these commandments there so you could see his grace. So he says, hey, look at me so you don't have to lie. Look at me so you don't have to steal. Look at me so you don't have to cheat. Look at me so you can honor your father and your mother. Look at me so you can keep the Sabbath day holy. Look at me so you don't have to live in this life of sin and death and destruction. Because the thing is, we are slaves to sin. We are slaves to death because we have signed that contract over to death and said, okay, I'm sinning, so here's my reward. Because I deserve death. That's all I deserve, you know? I don't deserve the opportunity to live, this opportunity to have free life that Christ gave me. But he says, there's something greater I have for you. Because I have this grace that you have this opportunity to accept and this opportunity to have it in your life to change your life so you can better reflect the image of who I am in you. Because in reality, without Christ, we're nothing. We're just a bunch of dust walking around in a formed body and just going throughout life because I don't deserve this grace. Because I never did anything worthy of deserving this grace. Yet he loves you so much that God sent Jesus down to die for you. And the awesome thing is, because he sent his son, if it was just you, if you were the only person who had ever done anything wrong, the only person who had ever sinned, and I know people always say this, but he would die for you even though you don't deserve any of it. Even though you don't deserve this price that he paid, because he put his life on the line for you and for me. Because he saw something in you. He saw something. He created you to do a purpose that he created no one else to do. And he wants you on his team. Because he wants you to march into eternity with him. Because the thing is, yes, we're sinful. And yes, our bodies are ill now. And we have sickness and we have disease. Yet that's not what we were created for. Because I don't know about you, whether you've had a very close person to you die or been by someone who had someone die, but it is hard. It is hard to experience death firsthand and to see the aftermath of death. Because those people, yeah, we can't see them anymore on this earth. And yes, we have the promise of Christ coming again, but it is hard. Because we were never made to experience the pain of death. We were never made to experience that, but yet we deserve it. We deserve that pain because by sinning we have accepted that. But grace is this amazing thing because we talk about amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. And I'm not here preaching at you to accept this grace, yet I'm here to stand because I know I don't deserve it. I know that I don't deserve this amazing gift that God has given me. I know that being 3 or 4 years old, I did not deserve my sister taking my punishment for me. Yet, she showed me grace. She showed me how much she loved me, how much she loved her little sister, and the fact that she was willing to take what I deserved. Christ shows me day after day that he died for me. And part of me is sad that I know the whole story of his death because for me growing up, I heard it my whole life. I was raised in an Adventist home, going to Sabbath school from like the babies to now. And you know, like you're stuck in this cycle. And the thing is, I know I've taken that story, taken that story for granted because I don't always realize how much he loves you and how much he loves me. And the thing is, we're all his children. And he has this amazing grace that he has paid. Because the thing is, whether you know it or not, whether you want to accept that gift, he's done the push-ups. He's done the death. He's done the beatings. He's done everything just for you and just for me. Because I don't know about you, but like, I would not have wanted to personally been beaten, be spat upon, be cursed out at, because I don't know about you, but I get really defensive. If someone comes for my life, trust me, I'm coming right back at you. I will fight you. But I'm not really a violent person. My friends know that. I kind of shy away. But at the same time, Christ had that all happen to him because he had you in mind. He has your name written on his heart and written on the palms of his hands because he took your sins over for you. Because Christ died in order that you may have life and you may have it abundantly. And I know that's one thing I keep trying to realize. Our theme verse for Southwestern this year is John 10:10, which is the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come that you may have life and have it abundant. So the thing is, whether you feel like you deserve this grace or not, whether you feel like you want to be with Christ or not, the thing is, he's calling to your heart because he has paid the price. The battle is already won. You just have to stand still and let him fight for you. Because in reality, he's going to win. He's the victorious one, and he's calling out your name Because I don't know about you, but I fill my schedule up. I'm taking 15 credit hours, which is actually not as much as I was taking last semester, but 5 of those credit hours happen to be the language of Greek. That is a painful language to learn. Yet, the thing is, you're always studying, you're always stuck in ministry, you're always stuck in hanging out with your friends because you don't want to have no social life. And like you're always doing something, and yet God calls us to be still so that he can fight the battle. Because I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel like I'm just fighting and I'm fighting and I'm fighting and I have nothing left to give. And he says, I know that. And he knows your heart and he knows what you're doing. And he has this amazing grace that he's willing to offer you because he's willing to stand in your place. And he's saying, you don't have to worry about this. You don't have to fight about this because I have you in my hands. God gave us this amazing grace to set us free from this bondage of sin so that we can be free indeed. Because I don't deserve this. You don't deserve this. We don't deserve this. Yet he sees you and he loves you so much that he gave his son down to die for you and to set you free so you can be free and you could spend eternity with him, because the wages of sin is death. But the free and wonderful gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So as we close out, silently within your hearts, if you really just want to give that to God and accept his amazing grace because you don't deserve it and come to the realization of you have nothing left to give. Because in reality, I don't even deserve to be sharing this message with you today. I shouldn't even be here. Yet, God wants you to hear of the amazing things that he can do through you and for you and with you. And all you have to do is stand still and let grace take over. So let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I just want to thank you for this amazing, amazing grace that you have given. Because God, in reality, I don't deserve this. I don't deserve any of this. The only thing that I deserve is death. Yet you see me and you say that you love me and you call to my heart and you ask me to accept this free gift because you have paid the price. You have done what is needed to be done so that I may spend eternity with you, and God, I praise you for that. And Lord, with each of these students, Lord, if they have something they want to say in their hearts to you this morning, I pray that they do. And Lord, if they want to accept you, to accept this grace, because in reality, grace is something we're never going to understand. And yet you give it to us freely so we can learn more about you each and every day. God, I pray that in each of their hearts this morning, they make that decision to give to you so that you may fill them with your grace and with your love, God. We love you and we just thank you for this Sabbath day, and be with us and everything else that's going on. And just, God, just be at the forefront of our lives. And Lord, I just thank you. I thank you for your amazing grace and for loving us so much. In your precious and holy name I pray. Amen.